Welcome to Inside Racing. If the rules of racing guaranteed rides for ageing jockeys, Cliff Clare might still be going around. He was still riding 10 years ago at age 62, but became despondent when he found himself getting only the odd ride at faraway meetings. Pretty hard to take for a jockey with 1,500 career wins behind him, including a coveted golden slipper. Always health conscious and having had very few race falls during a 45-year career, Cliff Clare was still a competitive professional jockey when Father Time tapped him on the shoulder. Let's find out what he's doing with himself 10 years after retirement. Cliffy Clare.
Good to see you, John.
How are you, mate?
I'm very well.
I can't believe it's 10 years since you gave it away.
No, it seems like 5 minutes, John.
Well, I'm in a reminiscent mood. Let's have a chat.
I love it.
Thanks, mate. Cliff, were you frustrated when the opportunities dried up and the phone stopped ringing?
Yes, well, probably after riding for so long, John. I think I rode for 45 years and the last few months I had to travel to Canberra and have one or two rides, and then I'd have to probably get one ride at Hawkesby and one at Wyong, Gosford, and one in the city. That's the last about time I turned it up, I think.
The frustrating part was that you were fit, you were healthy, and your nerve, I always felt, was as good then as it had been 30 years earlier.
True, John. I think I could have rode. I was 62 when I retired. I think I could have rode for another 4 or 5 years. I was that fit and nerves were still there, but I thought, well, it's not worth it. You easily fall off, and being that age, you get yourself injured and... So now I think it's about time to turn it up.
You were born in an era when big families were common, and you were the youngest of 10, born at Denman in the Hunter Valley of New South Wales.
Yeah, that's true, John. I was born in Denman, and then we went to Musselbrook and lived in Musselbrook until I was about 15 or 16.
Now, here is a lovely little photo out of your family album, taken in the mid-40s, you and Mum. Mum brought you to Sydney to go out to the AJC office in Bligh Street at the time to arrange your indentureship papers.
Yeah, that's true, John. Yeah, that was in Bligh Street. And the AJC used to be down there.
Yeah. Cliff, I should point out at this early stage of the interview that we will be hearing from the chiming clock from time to time.
I forgot about the chiming clock.
Now, your indentureship to a trainer called George McCann was the result of an announcement you heard on a Sydney radio station.
That's right, John, yes. That's how I actually became into the racing game. It was through Cliff Carey. And he was advertising for an apprentice jockey to go to a trainer. And I thought, well, there's an opportunity for me, so I got my... brother to ring up and make the arrangements, and I went in and I seen Cliff Carey and I spoke to him. He said, well, I know a trainer's looking for a boy. He said, I'll ring him up and make arrangements for you to go out and meet him.
Now, your master was George McCann, who trained his horses on the now defunct Rosebery track.
Rosebery and...
And so you've been in this district for most of your life?
Just about, John, yeah. Just to go to Ascot. Old Ascot Racecourse, he used to train there in Roseby, so he had the two tracks that we could use.
Now, was George McCann typical of the trainers of that day? Was he a tough taskmaster from your viewpoint?
Very hard and tough, John, yes, I'll say that. I used to say to myself, well, I wasn't going to last long there the way he'd go, but, John, when I finished my apprenticeship and became a fully-fledged jockey, I must say this, even the hardships that they had with him, I appreciated what he'd done for me, because you learn by only someone being hard and tough. You know, you couldn't do this, you couldn't do that, but he was very good that way, and I appreciated that.
Now, like most country kids who liked horses, you could ride bareback with the best of them.
But when you got to George McCann's place, riding bareback was of little use.
It's unbelievable. Don, when he went there, he said to me, "Can you ride?" I said, "Yeah, I can ride." He said, "Good, I want a jockey that can ride track works." And I ride up. So he come in, he brought in a grey pony and a saddle, and he said, "Here, saddle him up." Well, I finished up putting the saddle on. I put the girth that was on the surcingle and the surcingle on the girth straps, and I didn't have had a clue. He said, "I thought you could ride." And I said, "Yeah, I can ride." So he took the saddle and put it on. He said, "Now jump on there." He said, "Now you trot up down there, up the laneway." Mm. Well, I couldn't trot. I never knew what trot was.
No.
You bounce up and down. I kept hitting the saddle, and he'd come and he said, "Get off." He said, "I thought you could ride." I said, "I ride bareback." He said, "You don't ride racehorses bareback, son."
Yeah.
But he said, "I'll tell you what I'll do." He said, "I'll give you a job," because he said, "I want someone to work for me." He said, "I've got no one."
Yeah.
And that's how I come to get the job with him.
Well, you must have learned quickly, because it wasn't long before you had your first ride in a race at Gosford, and the horse's name was Delayed Action, and by your own admission, you slaughtered him.
I did, John, yeah. I did slaughter him. He should have won.
Now, your first win was at Kembla Grange, a track you had an association with for the rest of your career. Horse's name was Fort Game.
Fort Game, yeah. That was lovely when I rode my first win. I thought it was terrific. It was about me, I think I probably had about another three rides after that, and that was my first winner.
Yeah.
And then he won again the following fortnight after that on the same horse. So I rode another winner then on him.
At this stage of your career, who were your heroes among the other jockeys? Some of the senior riders obviously inspired you.
In my early days, I know Doug, I thought Darby Munn was a great rider, but I wasn't riding with Darby then. I used to just watch him as an apprentice, you know. Mm. But in my days of riding, look, I could name 20 jockeys, you know, Silwood and Cook and Mullies and Podmores and Moore, and they were all terrific riders, you know, and very, very good riders. But I suppose what I would put on top would be George Moore. I just thought he was a great rider, Moore, particularly through a race.
Yeah. So you were happy to be following him at any time?
Oh, unbelievable, yeah. You know, yeah. John, they used to say about Georgie Moore, he used to blow his whistle and that, but he knew whether a jockey was a whip-handed, right-handed whip rider, and he used to just tail them. If you used the whip and the ride, he knew you'd shift out, and he'd be through on a stride.
Yeah.
He's a great thinker through a race.
Well, Cliff, you had the good fortune and the privilege to take part in the making of a very famous Australian-made movie called The Sundowners in the mid-50s. What are your memories and recollections of that experience?
Yeah, well, that was good, The Sundowners. I enjoyed being in it. It's, there was Robert Mitchum, Deborah Carr, she was the main lady in that. And we had to go up and ride these racehorses, up and down the straight, about half a dozen horses. And I think it was Rodney Turner was the jockey that rode Silver Phantom. It was the grey horse in the race.
Yeah. And it was the real Silver Phantom.
The real Silver Phantom, yes.
Which had been trained by Jack Green.
Jack Green had him, yeah. Mm.
Won at Epsom.
Mm, that's right, he was a good horse.
Yeah.
And he was the stand-in jockey, Rodney Turner, on thing, and I rode the other horse that had to run second in the race. And he'd go past me and knock me down, and I'd have to get checked. So in the film that there was a protest that had carried on. It was very, very interesting.
I'm enjoying our chat, Cliff. We'll pause for a break now on Inside Racing. Then we'll come back and talk about your early years as a senior jockey when you preferred to get out of town. Back shortly with Cliff Clare. Newcastle was a happy hunting ground for Cliff Clare back in those days, and because of the prominent role you enjoyed there, you got yourself on a T.J. Smith-trained horse called Fox Mara to win a Newcastle Cup.
That's right, John, yes.
great thrill for you. That was 1959.
Yeah, it was a thrill, John, yes. And a special ride for Tommy Smith at the time, you know. And then coming out and win the Newcastle Cup on him, on the horse called Fox Mara, it was a great thrill.
Now, your career took an important turn in the mid-1960s when the old Rosebery training track was closed down.
Yeah.
And you were invited by a couple of Rose Hill trainers to start riding track work there.
Yeah.
And so began associations with trainers like Colin Papworth, Herb Sampson, Tommy Kennedy, and most importantly, Ted Stanton. Let's talk firstly about Colin Papworth, because through that association, you got on a brilliant two-year-old called Prince Max.
Prince Max is a very good horse, John. I won the size prodigies on Prince Max. He'd run in the slipper. He ran fourth in it. I think Storm Queen won the slipper.
Oh, what a great slipper field that was.
It was a good field, that. And he just wasn't a real sprinter early in the race, you know, which in those slippers you had to have a little bit of speed and be there. And he was suited really in the 1400 race, which the size produced, which he did eventually win.
And look, the winner a long way out?
Yes, he did, yeah.
He was a lovely little horse, wasn't he?
Oh, he was a dream to ride too. Lovely nature horse.
You had tremendous success with T.A.D. Kennedy, the late Tommy Kennedy, a trainer and a man for whom to this day you have high regard.
That's true, John, yes. Yeah, great trainer and a great bloke too. He stuck to jockeys, you know, which is a very rare thing in racing games, you know. He stuck by you.
Best horses you rode for Kennedy?
King Rado, I used to ride him. Royal Emblem, he was a handy horse. Castanier, he was another good horse. He won the Villiers. And I think Potty won the, I think it was an Epsom or a Doncaster on him.
But you rode him in the Villiers?
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, let's talk about Ted Stanton, a trainer with whom you formed a G. Moore, T.J. Smith-type partnership. You had great success and you were together for many years.
Many years, John, yes. It's particularly with a jockey and your trainer to last as long as we did. We went for a long, long while. But that was the type of fella he was, Teddy Stanton. He never queried your rides or condemned you or anything like that. He took it, he believed in you, and that's a great thing, and that's why we had such a good combination, and a great trainer too, a very good trainer, a good judge.
Now, Cliff, the association with Ted Stanton led you to your magic moment in racing. Sweet Embrace in the Golden Slipper Stakes.
That's right.
She started at cricket score odds, and her win was a major shock to many. But who cares?
Yeah.
Cliff Clare won a slipper.
That's true, yeah.
What do you... Now, sadly, there is no footage available of this Golden Slipper.
No, you wouldn't believe it's the only one there's not a footage of, John, the Golden Slipper.
Now, there was a technical reason for that, Cliff. Is that true?
Yeah, that's true. All you hear is the broadcast, not the race actually on the film itself.
I think there was a camera malfunction with the Observer Film Company, who were covering it for the stewards at the time.
Yeah.
None of the television stations was there because the slipper was still fairly low-key then.
Yeah, that's true, yeah. But still an important race, the slipper, for me to win and then feel that I can't even go and watch it where all the other Golden Slippers are there to be watched, you know. It's a disappointment to me.
It's the only one missing, isn't it?
That's right, the only one. It had to be mine.
Yeah. Well, mate, you better create some footage for us. Where were you in the run? What do you remember of the race?
John, I've got to say this. I thought she had some sort of a chance in the race because my intentions was she was a Todman filly, and normally they show a lot of speed, the Todmans, and I said to Teddy Stan, we worked out a plan that we would ride her back in about sixth or seventh and hold her up for the last probably 200 or 300 metres of the sprint. So I jumped out. I'll do about 7 alley, and I just jumped out and I didn't bustle. She could have led. I just eased her back to about 6th or 7th. And when I come around the home corner, I was just cantering, and I thought, oh my God, how am I going to get out of here? was Bolton.
Mm.
And all of a sudden, something outside of me just eased back a little. Well, I just went straight under his neck and got out.
Mm.
And I just give her a kick and she went crash. And I'll never forget the broadcast of Ken Howard. And he said, "What's this down the outside?" He said, "Sweetie Embrace." Well, she just cruised in about three lengths.
Yeah.
It was an enormous win. And it was just through holding her up that she won. Otherwise, she wouldn't have won if I'd jumped out and led on and been a Todman, because
yeah.
most of them had speed Todmans, but she was better just nurse back a bit.
If you had to pick your all-time favourite horse, would I be correct in assuming it was King's Delight?
That would be him, John.
You loved him?
Yeah, King's Delight, yeah. He was about two lengths off being a top racehorse, John. It's hard to say it, but he was. He just wasn't, I think he had a slight heart problem himself, King's Delight. And that's why he was never tops. But I won a lot of races on him, and gee, he was a lovely horse to ride.
Was he?
You could relate to him. He knew when you had to ease. He knew when you, if he'd seen horses up front getting checked, he'd start and rein up for you himself. He's so intelligent.
Freak.
And they're the type of horses that jockeys like to ride, because you can relate to them.
Mm. Do you still think about him in your quiet moments?
It's unbelievable. He went to stud, John, and he produced a lot of sprinters around the country meetings and that, and I was pleased and nice to see something by King's Delight, you know, come out and win. And I think Nutman's had him up and he stud up at Hawkesbury, you know, and there's a lot of horses won at Hawkesbury by King's Delight.
Yeah, you really loved him.
Oh, he's unbelievable, you know. Out of all the horses, and I rode a lot of handy horses, he was one of my favourites.
Now, another Ingham owned and Ted Stanton trained horse that was pretty good to you was Royal Britannia. You won a silver slipper on him.
Silver slipper, yes. He had his first run. He's a very lazy horse, would do nothing on the track. And I said to Teddy, "This is a really top horse, this." And he said, "He can't work." I said, "He doesn't have to work. He's a good horse."
Mm.
So we put him in at Rose Hill, and I spoke to Jack, and I said, "Jack, this is unbeatable." Mm. I said, "He's a good horse, this." He said, "He's never raced, you know," he said, "and he doesn't do nothing on the track." He said, "The clocker said he can't work." I said, "You make my words, he's good."
Mm.
So Jack backed him, and he won like a good horse. He's very good. And then I think he went to the Black Oval after that, but I didn't ride him. Johnny Duggan ride him in that, and he won the Black Oval, and then he got a virus.
Mm.
And that was the finish of him.
Another very good horse you rode was Duo. In fact, he gave you your second win in the Newcastle Cup.
He's Duo. He was trained by Ronnie Dickerson at Hawkesbury, and he was another good horse. I think I won a maiden on him at Hawkesbury at first. Very lazy horse. He used to hunt him all the way in a 1,200 metre race, 1,400 metre race, you'd hunt him all the way.
Mm.
And in the Newcastle Cup, he was up running third and fourth, and me niggling, clicking him, and the jockeys said, "Go past and look over at you." And
think
"Oh,
gone.
He's gone, you know."
Yeah.
But just when you really picked him up to go, he just kept going. He'd stay all day.
You were one of the lucky ones as far as race falls were concerned. You rode for 45 years and you were telling me you had maybe four or five race falls.
I didn't have many falls, you know. I was very lucky in that episode there, was falls. Probably might have had four or five in tracks, which is just the same as riding in races, riding racehorses, you can fall off. And I probably could just mention a fall that was really a simple fall, but it was in a Gosford race, and it was in a 600 metre race at Gosford, and I'd only jumped out of the barrier and went 20 metres or so, and my stirrup leather broke. And of course I led, and I thought, geez, what'll I do, pull it up or what? And I thought, oh, now I'll bring me left knee up and had them in two each close together like that, you know. And I went round like that, right round of the furlong pole and the 100 metres, and I thought, geez, I'm going to win this race with no one iron gone, one leather gone. And I thought, you beauty, I got to the post and I won the race, and I forgot that I'd braked, and I stood up in the irons to pull the horse up and fell off it. I'd forgotten that it broke.
Another one of my clearest memories of you was 2 weeks before your 60th birthday, you won a race at Rose Hill on a long-priced horse called Crown Joker.
But here they come now. Red Ed, Flag On and Swift Beat down the outside. Horses all over the place. Cage and tackle by Red Ed. Crown Joker getting a rails run. It's Crown Joker bursting through on the fence. And Crown Joker...
Now, there was a funny side to this win. As you were pulling up, I told the crowd on the public address system that you were getting close to your 60th birthday, and I pointed out that you'd ridden a dashing, daring race for a rider of your years. Well, by the time you got back to the gate, you got a Melbourne Cup reception. You must have been puzzled.
Well, it was pushing the crowd. I thought, gee, what's going on here? You know, he's only an old horse and he's won, but as you said, that's what it was.
Yeah.
But just the same, John, when you say that, you're telling me that now. Maybe that's why I never got all them rides after they told everyone how old I was.
I did you a bad turn. Sorry about that. But didn't they make a fuss of you after that race?
They did, John, yeah.
They had you out on the track taking pictures of you, jumping up in the air and
they
all sorts
see,
of things.
Yeah. I got up the top of the straight. I feel like a gig going up there. But that's what they wanted, and you'd like to try and help the media.
Looking back on 45 years as a jockey, any regrets at all?
John, I suppose I could say I probably had two. Probably I had an opportunity to go overseas to England. I said I'd probably go, and I waited till they sent the all the credentials come back and everything, but that took 3 weeks, and then that 3 weeks, I think if I fretted that much about going away, I said, no, I'm not going.
Yeah.
And when they'd come back to let me know where I was going, well, then I said, no, I'm not going. I knocked it back. And then I think about a fortnight after that, I had an opportunity to go to France. And I just shook my head straight away. I said, no, I don't want to go. I wasn't going to go up with that waiting. Just made me mind up. I said, no, I don't go overseas. I had my family and two children, and I said, no, it's not that important to me.
Now, Cliff, you mentioned the two kids, a boy and a girl.
Boy and a girl, John, yeah.
And there was never a hope of the boy being a jockey, was there?
No, John, he's about 16 stone, I think, 15 or 16 stone. But my daughter, she's built in my lines. She could have been the jockey.
Yeah, and we're talking about Steve and Robin.
Steve and Robin, yes.
Now, we haven't given your darling a mention yet.
My wife, yes.
And no Cliffy Clare story is complete without a tribute to Shirl.
That's
51 years married.
Yeah, 51 years, John, yes. It's a shame she won't come in and have film. She doesn't like to be photographed.
No, she was invited. She bolted.
True.
She's bolted.
That's
took
Shirley.
The door off the hinges getting out of the place.
That's Shirley. She very rarely went to the races. When she do to the races, she'd drive me. She'd sit in the car.
Yeah.
Very rarely come
not
here.
An avid race fan,
no,
was she?
No, that's true.
Yeah. Well, here you are, if I may. Can I give you up again? 72.
72, John.
That's the second time I've given you up. fit and healthy as ever. You still look to be your riding weight.
Yeah, well, John, I think I put on about 2 kilos, that's all, if I put that much on, you know.
Now,
I'm looking.
Golf dominates your life, and you're pretty good at it.
Well, not really, John. My handicap's 18, so, you know. But I enjoy it. That's the main thing, and especially at my age. And I still play and enjoy it.
So, Cliff, when you're not on the golf course, you're probably sitting in that lounge chair reflecting on a very fortunate life in racing. Racing was good to you, and Cliffy Clare certainly contributed largely to the Australian racing industry. A job well done.
Yeah, well, I've enjoyed it, John, and I'm happy that I've come out unscathed and as healthy as as I have, because a lot of them have been, unfortunately, accidents. And to come through it like that, I think that's the greatest gift that has ever been given to me.
And Cliffy Clare, the racing industry salutes your distinguished career. Thanks for all the great rides and thanks for the memories. Look forward to your company next time around when we introduce another famous face. Until then, many winners.